So let's meet the trio who will be joining us in our little den of antiquity, starting with a gentleman who not only manages to combine top-of-the-bill jazz singing with art criticism and essay writing, he's also done for bespoke tailoring roughly what the Charge of the Light Brigade did for recruiting, Mr. George Melly. Next to George, a striking lady who's paying her first visit here, the best-selling novelist with the knack of writing the kind of books you just can't put down, especially if there's children around, Miss Molly Parkin. And on our third cushion, well, let me tell you one of the things I've had to live with for over 30 years. It's the well-meaning person who gets up and says he needs no introduction, you've heard him on radio, you've seen him on television, and then announces me as, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Frank Muir.
Goodness, goodness. I'm a bit worried that Molly's hat is growing.
Well, keep an eye on it. Once it starts eating your bow tie, ring the bell, right? Let's tap the team's earliest memories of record buying. Now, Molly, did you used to spend your pocket money at the Woolworths record counter?
No, we didn't have a gramophone. Didn't have anything to play it on.
Why?
Well, it's just that was the sort of household.
Well, was it
the Welsh chapel house?
Oh, the Welsh, yeah.
So it's all hymns and things.
So when you started buying records, around about what period did you start?
Oh, I think my first record, yeah, when I was an art student later on, when we moved from Wales, was Doris Day, It's Magic.
Oh, you came and joined us around...
Yeah, a little bit later. Yeah. Used to play it down in the back kitchen, get the bloke in there, put the record on and
you were away, yeah. George, I used to be the bloke who had to put the record on for other people. George, what was the first record that you remember buying?
Buying?
Yeah, or stealing.
From Woolworths. I bought a record from Woolworths, but one of those little tiny ones that they sold, I think for sixpence. It was called... He played his ukulele as the ship went down.
Yeah, oh, yeah. Jack Hilton, was it Jack Hilton?
I think it was Jack Hilton.
Yeah, yeah. For now, Frank, when you were an earnest young Broadstairs lad,
I clearly go back a good deal farther than Molly. Well, clearly. And mine was with the sand in the grooves on the beach. And there was the Tiger Ragamuffins playing Tiger Rag, which consisted entirely of, oh, hold the tiger, oh, hold the tiger, oh, hold the tiger. And also a lovely one, was it Gertrude Long singing, won't you do what you done before?
Yeah. Ivan Morton and Dave Kay with the Tiger Ragamuffins, yeah. Right. What was your local cinema?
My local cinema, the same cinema I went to was a bit further than local. I used to much enjoy the Granada Walthamstow. It's a long walk.
From Broadstairs?
This is Leighton days. Mm. I suppose it's about 6 miles. But in those days, you used to get two big films.
Yeah.
One awful, one what you wanted to see, plus the organ coming up and the medley, plus cine variety. Plus loads of rubbishy shorts, and you staggered out over-entertained and exhausted after about 9 hours for 9 pieces. Yeah.
George, what was the favourite cinema of your youth?
Well, the first one I went to was called the Rivoli, but it was an early, rather scruffy one. I think the one that absolutely amazed me when it opened about 1935 was called the Mayfair. It had one of those marvellous curtains with ruches that they could shoot green up and pink down and then change them to purple and orange and the whole curtain. I mean, it was so exciting.
Where was this? What town?
It was in Egbeth Road, Liverpool. And it was quite near. It wasn't quite as near as another cinema called the Gaumont, but the Gaumont didn't have such a nice curtain.
Now, Molly, did you used to spend a lot of your youth in the cinema?
Yes, either at chapel or in the pictures, that's right. And the State Kilburn, which is an incredible building, isn't it? That really is Hollywood. Mm. I didn't like that so much as the one called the Hall down in Pondicummer, where I was born and brought up to, because that cinema had, they'd taken out the middle arms, so you had two seats, you know, for you and your boyfriend. Three back rows had all that happening, which I never saw in London.
And you thought you had an underprivileged childhood.
I was going to say, I remember that, at Leytonstone.
For lovers, yes.
Yeah,
so nobody was really looking at the film, except I was.
And you got a free cup of tea and a petit beurre biscuit.
Yes,
yes. And halfway through, a lady came round with an enormous brass canister and pumped it up and sprayed you with full nada.
Leighton was the Latin Quarter in those days.
Clearly.
Well, now, you are one of the most hardy hat wearers that I know. Have you always worn a hat?
Oh, no, I took to it in middle age.
Yeah?
But since then, I've always worn one.
But during the 40s, when you were only a lad, what was the most outrageous item of apparel that you remember wearing?
Well, I used to wear outrageous things to annoy my mother. I found in the acting box a moleskin waistcoat partially destroyed by moths, and I wore that. It didn't make her cross.
That explains a lot, didn't it? Frank, did you ever wear a hat? And I can't remember.
Wouldn't mind wearing one like moles, yeah? which makes a statement.
Yes.
There's awful floppy... No, I never did wear them.
What sort of items of clothing did you aspire to wearing when you were about 16? What did you always dream of seeing?
I secretly dreamed of wearing a velvet smoking jacket.
Ah.
I don't mean a jacket on fire.
No.
I mean,
yeah.
Where you sit in a leather armchair, as in Stars on Sunday.
Yeah.
In this thingy with the...
Oh, well, you get to it.